Hey, good afternoon, everyone. It's Pastor Bramick here at Holy Shepherd. It is Wednesday, January the 25th. It's time for our daily devotion. We are making our way through the book of Romans, and we're in chapter 14 today. So if you'd like to turn there now and join me, we're going to start at verse 1. Accept him whose faith is weak, without passing judgment on disputable matters. One man's faith allows him to eat everything, but another man, whose faith is weak, eats only vegetables. The man who eats everything must not look down on him who does not, and the man who does not eat everything must not condemn the man who does, for God has accepted him. Who are you to judge someone else's servant? To his own master he stands or falls, and he will stand, for the Lord is able to make him stand. One man considers one day more sacred than another. Another man considers every day alike. Everyone should be fully convinced in his own mind. He who regards one day as special does so to the Lord. He who eats meat eats to the Lord, for he gives thanks to God. And he who abstains does so to the Lord, and gives thanks to God. For none of us lives to himself alone, and none of us dies to himself alone. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. For this very reason, Christ died and returned to life, so that he might be the Lord of both the dead and the living. You then, why do you judge your brother, or why do you look down on your brother? For we will all stand before God's judgment seat. It is written, as surely as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow before me, every tongue will confess to God. So then, each of us will give an account of himself to God. Therefore, let us stop passing judgment on one another. Instead, make up your mind not to put any stumbling block or obstacle in your brother's way. As one who is in the Lord Jesus, I am fully convinced that no food is unclean in itself. But if anyone regards something as unclean, then for him it is unclean. If your brother is distressed because of what you eat, you are no longer acting in love. Do not by your eating destroy your brother for whom Christ died. Do not allow what you consider good to be spoken of as evil. For the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Because anyone who serves Christ in this way is pleasing to God and approved by men. Let us therefore make every effort to do what leads to peace and to mutual edification. Do not destroy the work of God for the sake of food. All food is clean, but it is wrong for a man to eat anything that causes someone else to stumble. It is better not to eat meat or drink wine or to do anything else that will cause your brother to fall. So whatever you believe about these things, keep between yourself and God. Blessed is the man who does not condemn himself by what he approves, but the man who has doubts is condemned if he eats, because his eating is not from faith, and everything that does not come from faith is sin. Okay, so this is a very, I think, important chapter. And it's really talking about how, let's look at it this way. There are things in Scripture that this reminds us of, and I'm thinking of, say, the Galatians 3 chapter that talks about Paul condemns people who believe that they're going to be saved by obeying the things of the law. That's not what this is, okay? So Paul does not make any comments here that the people who are holding one day a week as sacred or eating only vegetables, that they don't view that as being their salvation. They don't think they have to eat vegetables to be saved. They don't think they have to have a one-day observance of a sacred day in order to be saved. But Paul talks about them as this is being a matter of conscience. Now, he does talk about a weakness in faith here, that maybe people are still holding on to those things. And it's thought that maybe he's talking about some Jewish people who were in the congregation at Rome who were still observing many of the Old Testament rites. And so the feast days, the dietary restrictions, the Sabbath, right? But they were not doing so thinking that they were going to be saved by them. They were not viewing the law as a means of salvation as the congregations like Lystra and Derbe over in Galatia were doing. But still, Paul talks about them as being weak in faith because they still have some degree of necessity about this. But Paul makes it clear, hey, don't destroy your brother, don't attack your brother because he is doing this. You know, there's lots of things in the church that fall under the umbrella of what we call adiaphora, meaning it's something that's neither commanded nor forbidden by God. So adiaphora is a German word, and it means the middle thing. And, you know, there's lots of things that we could put in there, crossing yourself during the service, you know, things like that, individual acts of piety, you know, differences between congregations and how they observe certain things, whether or not they have a crucifix, whether or not you bow and reverence the altar before you go to the rail, whether or not you say amen after you say you receive the Lord's Supper, and so many other different things that fall under this banner of freedom of conscience. And although Paul doesn't use that expression here, the concept is certainly there. That, you know, that you have, there is some freedom in observing your faith. And it's not to the point where you can compromise on major doctrines, right? And view Jesus however you want him to, ever want to, or, you know, see the sacrament as being just symbolic or something like that. That's not what we're talking about here. But more of these sort of private, I don't want to say rituals, but private behaviors or thoughts or conceptions that different Christians may have about what they view as being an expression of their faith, what's important to them. So we're not talking about fundamental things here. Now, of course, we do know that the fundamental thing is that Jesus died for our sins on the cross and that by believing in him, we have the promise of everlasting life. And so that is an essential, and that's not something that we can compromise on. But these ways that we express our faith that are discussed here in Romans chapter 14 are things that we should take into consideration, that we should not look down on others because they don't do them. We should not think of ourselves too highly because we do them. It's easy to get a sense of arrogance about ourselves, believing someone's not as expressive, as faithful, as devout as we might be because we believe this is something that is essential. So this discussion about adiaphora in the church is an ongoing topic. It's lasted for centuries. It's going to last until Jesus returns. But I just wanted to make you aware of it because Paul is talking about it here in his letter to the Romans. All right, let's continue now as we pray together the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. All right, announcements for today. Email newsletter is going to be coming out in just a little bit. We're going to have some information in there about our upcoming Lenten theme, which is starting less than a month now. It's called Songs of Suffering, and we're going to be going through a number of the well-known hymns that are sung during the season of Lent, talking about the history, the meaning, the theology behind these hymns. So we really hope that you can be here for our midweek services. The first one will be our Ash Wednesday service, then that starts on Wednesday, February the 22nd. Now, we are planning to have something in the morning, an imposition of ashes service happening in the morning, and then an evening service at its usual time at 7 p.m., because some people might want to wear the ashes all day, and so we think that that's an important way to express our faith. So we'll have some more announcements about that coming up, so just stay tuned for everything there. Let's see. Seeds of Faith Fund is still open and still ongoing, so we invite you to make contributions to that. And speaking of contributions, your yearly contribution statement is going to be in your church mailbox this Sunday, along with the State of the Church letter for the past 6 months. So if you would like to review your statement, you can let Wes Wempner know if you see any discrepancies in there, that you use these things for your taxes and whatnot. And so he can be alerted to any contributions that may have been missed or not applied correctly. So please review those letters. Come up to your church mailbox here after service on Sunday and pick those up. All right, that's all the announcements I have for today. Thank you for watching our daily devotions. I'll be back tomorrow as we continue on in the book of Romans. And then Elizabeth will be here on Thursday. God bless. I'm sorry, on Friday. God bless the rest of your day.